Well, I went back teaching in Ann Arbor, seemed pretty dull. And with Kirby not wanting to go, I said, I promise I'll come back in 3 years. And 3 years later, 2 more years of Ann Arbor and teaching. I guess 3 years of teaching, then we came by. I did get a Guggenheim. I applied again, and I got one, and we went back and spent a year. And the first year was the best year of that marriage, and the second year was probably the worst. And I'm not going to go into it, but it was the beginning of the end. The marriage ended when I left the house in 1967. The 2 years in Thaxted were 59-60 and 63-64, and the marriage hung on for another 3 years, but it was pretty much over by then. And that was a time in my life when, well, a marriage ended after 2 years. I lived only a couple of blocks away from my kids, so I saw a lot of them, but there was failure in that. But it was also true that my work was getting overlooked. I wasn't writing so much. For 5 years, I was single. And during those years, I did not write so much. I drank a lot. I had lots of girlfriends. I was pretty miserable, really, through much of the time. Or way up and way down, maybe. I did have psychotherapy with a psychoanalyst. I did not. There were 8 psychoanalysts in Ann Arbor, more than there were in Vienna, but only one of them would do therapy. And so I was old enough, by the time I went to him, late 30s, that analysis therapy was moot. Would analysis actually help? So I saw him a maximum of 3 times a week. And we sat in chairs opposite each other. He still did not talk very much, left the talking up to me. In the first 6 months, I lectured him about psychoanalysis, figuring his education was inferior. This is a classic way of dealing with your pain, you know. And then he sort of said, let's not see each other for a while. And then a little later, I was hurting enough, so I came back and began to use up the Kleenex and began to find things out. But it was invaluable to me, and it allowed me eventually to love Jane and to enter into the best part of my life. Toward the end, at one point, I was talking about probably some relationship or other, and I said, will I ever be able to love anybody? And he said very matter-of-factly, oh, yes, you'll be able to love, yeah. He was talking to me by that time. The first few years, he would hardly say anything. He had very eloquent eyebrows. And when I said something there, I mean, I explained my motive or something, and the eyebrow would flicker. And I know I'd just said something funny. I think what I learned from him, you know, there weren't eureka moments. I talked a lot to analysts. They have told me, whenever anybody says eureka, it's always false. There were no eureka moments. But what I learned a lot was that I had been naming feelings crudely and mistakenly, and that there were times when I might say I love when, I mean, I hate and fear. Remarkable. There was the intensity was there, but the label for the intensity was wrong. That's one reason why a poem can tell the truth without the poet knowing it. The intensity can convey the incredibly mixed reality of the feeling. Feelings are never pure without the writer being in intellectual command of what they are. Psychoanalysis is a language art. And again, I kept trying to convince him of this. He had a wonderful ear for puns and metaphors. I would say some cliché, not using it literally, just the way it's commonly used. And the eyebrow would flicker, and I'd realize that was precisely the right word, you know, and it revealed something. I went through, went back over lots of things, painful things in my past that were fairly hidden, and I began to change. It was enormously helpful. Unfortunately, by this time, it's so expensive, and there's been so much anti-Freud business around that it's hard to get a real Freudian analysis anymore. But I have known several people who have been enormously helped by them. And, of course, we all know many people who have not been helped. It goes without saying.